So this time we will speak about three features about the halo sign, the nodular vascularity, and the extrathyroidal spread. Do you see this PowerPoint presentation?
Yes, you see it.
Yes, okay.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Yes.
So in this presentation, I summarized the pre-recorded video lectures in 20 or 25 minutes. I only briefly mentioned some important practical aspects of halo sign and vascularity, and I will talk more about the extrathyroidal extension. So first, the halo sign. What is this? This is a hypoechoic rim that surrounds a portion of thyroid tissue and thus separates it from the rest of the thyroid gland. It is advisable to maintain the name halo for cases where the hypoechoic ring is complete or almost complete. There are various explanations for the halo sign. Different histological entities are presented in the form of halo, which may correspond to a capsule or a pseudocapsule or surrounding capsular vessels or compressed thyroid tissue. In these two small nodules, the presence of halo sign is obvious. Note the complete rim around both nodules. Here, here, and here. Almost complete. In larger lesions, it is more difficult to visualize the complete ring in the same section. In the left nodule, the halo is almost complete, but in the right case, the halo can be seen only in part of the circumference of the lesion. It may be partly explained by technical reasons. So here we can see the halo sign, but at the dorsal part of the nodule is much difficult to visualize. Both cases proved to be follicular adenoma, therefore they had to be surrounded with capsule. Another possible issue arises in hypoechoic nodules, particularly in deeply hypoechoic lesions. This situation is demonstrated in the left nodule, which proved to be also a follicular adenoma. The halo sign was also absent in the right case, which also was diagnosed as follicular adenoma on histopathology. This case demonstrates the role of perinodular vascularity, which can be of help in detection of capsule when halo is absent. The more possible explanation is that the halo has a similar echogenicity as the nodule, so it does not appear in the event of deeply hypoechoic nodules. This table summarizes the findings of a meta-analysis of Campanella and co-workers. The data provide a very encouraging picture of the potential role of halo. The absence of halo significantly increases the incidence of cancer. The odds ratio is greater than in the event of microcalcification. However, these numbers are deceptive. None of the thyroid classification systems or guidelines enlist the absence of halo among suspicious ultrasound characteristics. One of the main reasons for this is that in contrast, for example, to microcalcifications, great proportion of benign nodules also lack the halo sign. The other is even more important. As I will demonstrate, follicular cancer behaves just the opposite of papillary cancer. The most common feature of a follicular neoplasia is the halo sign. So if we relied on the absence of halo, most follicular cancers would be overlooked. I have mentioned several times that because of overwhelming majority of thyroid cancers are papillary tumors, therefore the features of papillary cancer dominate our image of thyroid cancers. Papillary and follicular tumors behave quite differently for most suspicious signs. The differences are statistically significant regarding all suspicious features. And these differences are not only of statistical importance, but these two types of cancers behave just the opposite. And this is the case also for halo sign. This very important figure has been presented several times and demonstrates the completely opposite behavior regarding ultrasound presentations of follicular cancer and papillary cancer. This time I highlight the difference in presenting HALO. The occurrence of HALO sign in follicular cancers is more than 3 times higher than in papillary cancer. There is another issue in this field. The conventional and the follicular variant of papillary cancer behave again differently. The differences are again not only of statistical importance, but except for non-parallel orientation, the two forms of papillary cancers have a completely different ultrasound presentation. If we focus on the HALO sign, the difference between the two forms of papillary cancer is of a similar order of magnitude as between follicular and papillary cancers. So it is not surprising that none of the thyroid systems involve HALO sign in their classification. Only the AACA mentions a special form of nodules with HALO sign among other, which are characteristic of the benign category. So I finished with the short summary of HALO sign. Does anybody have questions? Comments? If not, I go further. And follow with the next feature, the vascular patterns. This is a more complex topic. The vascularity of the nodule was the hottest topic in thyroidology 15 years ago. After the years of enthusiasm, it became clear that it will not bring salvation for thyroid problems. Essentially, two basic types of vascular patterns exist, depending on the location where the flow can be visualized. The peripheral or perinodular, which means that blood flow can be detected at least 25% at the circumference of the nodule. This type of vascularization corresponds either to vessels running in the true capsule or to compressed vessels located outside the nodule in question. The second type of flow can be observed in the central part of a nodule, and this is called intranodular vascularity. In contrast with the former, there is no definition in the literature for intranodular blood flow. One can speak of intranodular blood flow even if a single red spot is found. This minimal blood flow surely has another meaning compared with the chaotic type, hugely increased vascularity. Not all professional companies deal with the vascularization of nodules. For example, the ACR does not mention nodule vascularity. 3 different groupings can be read in the procedures. I present here only the classification of the European Thyroid Association. In the event of type 1 vascularity, there is neither perinodular nor intranodular flow. If peripheral flow predominates, we speak of type 2. If intranodular prevails, we speak of type 3 pattern. The former 2 subgroups have a relatively good negative predictive value for thyroid cancer, but this mainly shares statistical and not practical importance. We lack clear definitions and therefore the inter-observer agreement is necessarily low. The visualization of vessels and blood flow depends largely on settings. It would be much more important if thyroid specialists agreed on whether to evaluate the vascularization of the nodule alone or whether to compare to vascularization to the blood flow of the extranodular tissue. The difficulty of standardization means that each device and each investigator use different settings. This main difficulty could be resolved if we compare the nodule vascularity to the blood flow of the extrathyroidal tissue. Tremendous efforts have been made to use vascularity for differentiating benign and malignant nodules, and essentially these efforts have failed. However, as a byproduct, all experienced ultrasonographers use Doppler mode in the everyday practice. I present some of the possible applications. First, 2 quite simple examples. There is a deeply hypoechoic or anechoic lesion in the lower part of the thyroid lobe. Here on grayscale mode, And color Doppler mode disclosed that this is not a cystic lesion, but a vessel. The right patient was operated on thyroid cancer and presented with multiple hypoechoic lesions in her left thyroid bed. Here are these hypoechoic lesions. The ventral, more hypoechoic, proved to be not a vessel, but a reactive type lymph node. So a simple task, we choose the Doppler mode and we can reveal which the hypoechoic lesions are vessels and which are not. In the left case, there is a hypoechoic mass ventral to the thyroid lobe. Here we can see. It was not evident on grayscale mode whether this is a thickening of the muscle fiber or another structure. Color mode proved that this cannot be muscle fiber, and finding the aspiration cytology disclosed papillary cancer from this lesion. The right case presents a similar situation. The origin of the deeply hypoechoic linear mass between the muscle fiber and the thyroid was in question. On grayscale mode, it was conceivable that this could be also muscle fiber. However, the increased vascularity excluded the possibility. The lesion proved to be a parathyroid adenoma. These cases illustrate the potential of vascularity in non-nodular diseases. Both patients presented with severe degree of iodine-induced hyperthyroidism caused by amiodarone. They did not have to wait for the results of the other tests in either case. We were able to start the appropriate treatment immediately. Based on the extremely increased vascularity, the left case is clearly a type 1 amiodarone-induced thyrotoxicosis, while based on the lack of vascularity, the right case must be a type 2 amiodarone-induced thyrotoxicosis. These four images came from the same patient. The patient was operated for papillary cancer. Three discrete lesions were seen on transverse scan. Two of them proved to be vessels on color Doppler mode. While the third one here proved to be a muscle fiber. Note the upper and lower tail marked with green arrows. Both of these patients were operated on papillary cancer and presented with a small hypoechoic lesion in the left thyroid bed. Such hypoechoic fields can correspond to connective tissue or muscle fibers as well. However, if vascularity is disclosed within, these possibilities can be excluded. Both lesions prove to be thyroid tissue, so this one, and the left recurrent papillary cancer. So in this case, the vascularity disclosed the thyroid origin. I finished with the summary of the vascularity, and I ask you again whether you have questions, comments, any issues about this short summary. Nobody? Everything is clear? Okay, then I follow with the third and last topic. So I will speak more about extrathyroidal extension. Together with irregular borders and the irregular shape, extrathyroidal extension belongs to those features which rely on the invasive nature of thyroid cancers. Two topics will be discussed. First, the changing role of extrathyroidal extension in the newest TNM classification system. Thereafter, the use of ultrasound signs in the everyday practice. One of the most important changes in the 8th edition of TNM staging is the removal of the minor extrathyroidal extension from the definition of T3 disease in the event of differentiated thyroid cancer, if ETA was detected only on histological examination. This led to downstaging a significant number of patients from stage 3 to either stage 1 or stage 2 disease. Minor extratidal extension does not influence neither the T category nor the staging of the tumor. Perhaps it is not an exaggeration to even call the new TNM schedule paradigmatic, given that up to 70% of the most common thyroid cancers have been given a different staging compared with the former TNM classification. The second change is a very important consideration, and clinicians should be aware that gross extratidal spread is handled in a pathological staging system, not as a pathological, but as a clinical finding. We have three tools on which a gross extratidal spread can be diagnosed: preoperative radiological findings, intraoperative surgical findings, and the postoperative macroscopic evaluation of the specimen. Be aware that microscopic analysis has no role in the judgment, because the role of microscopy is limited to minimal extension, which has absolutely no influence on staging. According to the TNM rulebook, radiological findings have to be integrated into the pathologic workflow. So a preoperative ultrasound diagnosis of extratidal spread has a deep consequences. The final consequence remained unchanged: extratidal extension has a deep impact on further therapy of patients. Let me emphasize an unusual circumstance once more. Microscopic analysis has virtually no role in determining extratidal spread. This is because the degree of it visible only with a microscope no longer affects the clinical stage, and among factors which influence the staging, microscopic analysis has no role. Let's see the main table of the TNM staging. First, let me ask you to focus on the left column. The basic distinction is the minor and the gross extratidal extension. The latter has 3 degrees according to the anatomical structure invaded. As we go down, the degree of extratidal spread increases. The microscopic analysis has a role only in the finding of minimal extension. Here, to the point of a finding, I run forward. This is very important to us. Minimal extratidal spread is what ultrasound is best for. Essentially, ultrasound is suitable for which its clinical and prognostic significance has ceased to exist. Following with the circle, we can see that minimal extension has no role in the TNM status. While depending on the extent of gross spread, the tumor belongs either to T3 or T4 category. Another important change in the new system is that the age limit has been elevated from 45 to 55 years. Let's see the fourth column. Under the age of 55, all cases belong to stage 1 clinical group except for patients with distant metastasis. So in younger patients, extratidal spread, even the gross form, has no role in the clinical staging. It means that, for example, a younger patient with a papillary cancer that breaks into the trachea has an average chance of 98 to 100% chance for a 10-year disease-free survival. As I have emphasized, according to the TNM system, radiology is one of the 3 means by which gross extratidal extension can be demonstrated. In contrast with surgical exploration and the gross pathological examination, which rely on the reality, radiological examination requires interpretation of images and videos. In other words, while the two tools depend mainly on the thorough analysis of a visible and palpable specimen by the surgeon and the pathologist, as I will demonstrate, there is a deep concern about the radiology as a tool on which the further management of a patient may be based on. What is the cause for the concern about this suggestion. This table shows the main statistical parameters of ultrasound and MRI regarding their performance in detection or exclusion of extratidal spread. I focus on the probably most important one, on the positive predictive value. If radiology were indeed suitable for judging extratidal propagation, these values would have to be very high. This value is really very good in the judgment of minimal extratidal extension. However, as we have already learned, minimal spread has no relevance in the further staging and therapy of patients. In terms of gross extension, the positive predictive values are much worse at only around 50%. These values mean that neither ultrasound nor MRI is accurate enough to be the basis of a decision that affects the patient's fate. If we relied on these radiological findings, more than half of the patients were upgraded regarding the clinical or pathological status. This table shows the performance of the two methods in judging the infiltration of major anatomical structures. The positive predictive values range from 14 to 62, which means that neither ultrasound nor MRI is able to judge the degree of gross extension. As the data prove, the role of radiology, including ultrasound, is the exclusion of extratidal spread. In this area, the results are excellent. The study of Kim and co-workers is not an exception, but the rule. Other studies had a similar conclusion. The ultrasound assessment of the extratidal extension shows a wide range of diagnostic sensitivities, specificities, and accuracy values for the diagnosis of the extratidal extension, but the positive predictive value is below 50%. So what lessons can be... some thoughts about the CT. The diagnostic performance of computer tomography is similar in the judgment of extratidal spread. The positive predictive value is again around 50%. So, what lessons can be learned from these data? The newest TNM classification assumes that radiology is suitable for judging not only the existence of a spread, but also the extent of the extension. In fact, none of the preoperative radiological methods are suitable to influence the postoperative treatment or prognosis of the patients. It is obvious that we can rely on radiological examination regarding neither the presence nor the extent of gross extratidal spread. In my opinion, current protocols and algorithms have serious responsibility to deceive pathologists. The clear wording required in the radiological report is not backed by professional and scientific evidences. While there is no room for uncertainty in the medical report, in most cases we only guess that a certain characteristic is present, and this is particularly true for extratidal spread. Naturally, experienced teams are aware of the severe limitations of ultrasound and other radiological modalities in the judgment of extratidal extension, but this uncertainty is absolutely lacking in the wording of guidelines. The gravity, the severity of the problem is shown by the fact that such a well-renowned publication, the TNM classification, is to say at least misleading. While radiological examinations and ultrasound has no systematic role in the detection of extratidal spread, the gross form, these tools have a great potential in the event of extratidal extension, but this potential is not the justification, but the exclusion. I think it is worth making a distinction. Ultrasound signs of extratidal spread are used for two purposes. First, to detect and diagnose extratidal spread, and this was discussed before. The second is to use these signs for predicting malignant behavior of a thyroid nodule irrespectively of the real extratidal extension. In this sense, the ultrasound signs of extratidal spread are similar to all other suspicious signs. Indeed, the three American thyroid systems enlist extratidal spread among suspicious signs, however, all fail to define when to speak of extratidal extension. There are three ultrasound features on which we can suspect extratidal growth, or we can state that the sign of extratidal extension as suspicious characteristic is present. These are the discontinuous capsule, the abutting and bulging contours. In this table, I've summarized my suggestions for practical application. If the capsule is continuous or the nodule is non-abutting, it means that there is normal thyroid tissue between the nodule and the edge of the thyroid, then there is a minimal, if any, chance of extrathyroid growth. If the capsule is discontinuous and the nodule lies on the surface of the lobe, it has abutting contours, then extratidal extension can be considered, or we can state that this suspicious sign is present. So I've finished with this introductory lecture. I ask you again, make comments or take questions. Most of them are unmuted, so if somebody will speak, please unmute yourself.
I have a question.
Uh-huh. Please.
Are there any signs to predict if the capsule is disrupted the distance between the nodule and the capsule, for example 2 millimeters or 1 millimeter, I have a suspect that the capsule is disrupted by the nodule.
Okay, as I understand, you asked whether the capsule disruption and the distance between the nodule and the capsule are important or not. Yes, these are important. If the nodule is located within 1 or 2 millimeter from the capsule, then we cannot exclude the possibility. Larger the distance, smaller the chance of extratidal spread. But we can never forget that occasionally minimal or microscopic invasion exists, and if we see thyroid tissue, normal thyroid tissue before the nodule, we cannot fully rule out. But most extratidal spreads occur when the nodule is in close contact to the capsule. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Other comments, questions? So one more consideration. Indeed, the thyroid does not have a true capsule. It has only a pseudo capsule, and as I will present with some cases, this capsule is in most cases discontinuous. But if this discontinuation is seen at the very proximity of a nodule, then this is one of the three signs on which we can rely on extratidal spread. But this is not an absolute proof, it cannot be, because normally the thyroid capsule is disrupted. Other comments, questions? Any of you, Gilles or Andrea, comments? No?
Well, hello, Thomas, hello to everybody. Just a comment on vascularization. I would say that I in my practice, at least, I find more useful to get a look to the vascular organization of nodules, maybe when I perform fine needle aspiration as compared to just ultrasound evaluation. I mean, while I find it useful maybe to evaluate whether the nodule is very rich in vascularization, and this maybe could prompt myself to use, 27 gauge needle instead of a 25 or something. I mean, or to perform the procedure trying to be less, more soft, softer as possible toward the tissue, no? In order to limit the possibility of to blood in sampling. What's your opinion about this?
Yes, I absolutely agree with you. In the event of a well vascularized nodule, I occasionally use the non-aspiration technique. And no suction, and if I spread the material on the glass and I see nothing, occasionally I repeat the tests. But it is a very difficult problem because a great proportion of papillary cancers are well vascularized, and we have to target these vascularized portions, so occasionally it worsens, decreases the diagnostic performance of aspiration cytology. So I don't think that vascularity has no role. It has a very significant role. We used to perform Doppler method in the event of a thyroid, and not only in nodular goiter patients, but even in thyroiditis cases. I highlighted that no one algorithms uses any type of vascularity as suspicious sign. It does not mean that this is not an important feature. It's very important, and it would not be a good idea to miss vascular pattern from our analysis. Other questions, please? No one? Okay. If not, I follow with the interpretation, the demonstration of the cases.